Thank you so much for joining us this evening for what I believe will be a lively discussion and lively series of lectures, and then a panel discussion that will follow the lectures, centered around the exhibition we opened last night, Post-War Art Between the Pacific and the Atlantic. I think that an exhibition of the scale and ambition such as the one we are currently presenting, you know, requires not just one, two, or three lectures to unpack. It requires a multiplicity of approaches to forms of historical writing to come to terms with what it means not simply to be in the world, but to be of the world, to be part of the world. As is so often in hegemonic histories, there is oftentimes an attempt to think of history as that which is written by those who possess the tools of power, the tools of domination, or the loudest tribunes. And in that context, it's oftentimes forgotten that history at best is asymmetrical and is asynchronic. And the same goes with art. The same goes with culture. And that if we look at the entire history of human civilization, it's very clear that there is not a single culture or place in the world that does not possess the imaginative tools to deal with the complexity of the world. Oftentimes, that language is art. Art, in many ways, is that symbolic tool to contend with abstraction, the abstraction of the world. But coming closer to our time, we seem to lose the idea that humans across the world have puzzled with that abstraction, the abstraction of the meaning of what, you know, culture represents, the abstraction of the production of meaning, or turning abstraction to ideas that are legible, that are understandable, that are that provoke new insights into the way in which things are handled, whether it's language, whether it's material, whether it's the use of instruments and so on. So it's only, it seems, when we arrive at the moment of modernity that we seem to lose this idea that there is a bigger and greater involvement of practitioners from every part of the world, from the remotest cultures to the ones that are the most visible. So post-war, in that sense, begins with posing the question, what if we made an exhibition that not only thinks the world, but it is of the world, and that it is imbricated in the complexity of the world. What if we make an exhibition that uses a particular historical event as a signpost to think about the mechanisms and the contributions of art to the rendering of history? So, in a way, we've said this repeatedly, that post-war, and when I say we, I mean Katie Siegel, Ulrich Vilmes, and myself, the curators of the exhibition, that our ambition in the making of the exhibition is not to write a new history. But in many ways, it is also a new history. But the ambition is not simply to rewrite, but in a sense, to open up the possibility that the narrative of post-war art could be bigger, it could be broader, but not necessarily end up in this question where we discuss artistic production from the point of view of ultra-modern, the alternative modernities or parallel modernities. We twist ourselves into pretzels to come up with notions to describe how to fix or to place artists whose ideas and works and local and regional and national languages might seem at first unfamiliar to us. And what we have done in the exhibition is to say, well, whatever the language, let's put them in dialogue with each other, you know, based on ideas and research that many scholars have done and many are producing as we speak, to open up the debate about what constitutes post-war history. I don't want to sort of to rehearse so much of the arguments that are already in the exhibition. I think many of you, or if not all of you, have seen the exhibition already, or have been at least through it. And so you are aware that we have artists from 65 countries, from 5 continents, and that we have artists across many generations, several generations, not many, several, whose works have been brought together, you know, to unpack the, or to begin to produce what we hope to be not an alternative history of post-war art, as if there is the history to which there's an alternative, but to open up the various precincts of artistry that seem up until recently to be under lock and key. So the exhibition we've made is also deliberately structured as an argument. 8 arguments, call them themes, that drive the different constellations of practice, thinking, making, presentation, because the exhibition is not only just about the artists, it's also about audiences that encounter these artworks, both during the time they were made and at this particular time in which they have been presented together, many for the very first time. I could not imagine that Mariyuki Iri and Mariyuki Toshi's Hiroshima panels have ever been presented with Joseph Boyce's Monuments to the Stag, or Frank Stellar's Abbot Mike Fry, you know, presented, you know, with Henry Moore's Atomic, Atom Peace. But the bringing them together is all too plausible, and it makes sense. And the first section of the exhibition underscores that sense, that it's not quite tabula rasa, but, and it is not quite, you know, as the subtitle of Aftermath says, Zero Hour and Atomic Era, is not necessarily completely, you know, empty time, but is a troubled landscape. And I think that the, as I've mentioned in the past few days, that the supposition of the exhibition, at least from the beginning or in the beginning of the show, is not transcendental. It's very troubling. It's about this dark side of history. But it's from there that we begin to dig out of that dark side, out of the ruin, and then to move to the various registers of the argument that we put together, eight single exhibitions in one body. And I would love to say a lot more about the exhibition, but I think that the reason why we are here this evening is to hear, you know, three distinguished scholars, each coming from different parts of the world, each deeply invested in the attempt we are trying to make to open up an argument. Katie Siegel, who will be the first speaker, I'm going to introduce all three now, who is going to be the first speaker, and as a curator of the exhibition of post-war. And you know, Katie is the inaugural Eugene V. and Claire E. Thor Endowed Chair in Modern American Art at Stony Brook University, and Senior Programming and Research Curator at Baltimore Museum of Art. Her books include The Heroine Paint After Frankenfeller, Since 45, America and the Making of Contemporary Art, and Abstract Expressionism. She has written numerous catalog essays on modern and contemporary artists, including Willem de Kooning. That's what Tim told us to say. It's not de Kooning, it's de Kooning. Willem de Kooning, Vals, Georg Baselitz, Frank Stellar, Magnus Plessen, Ebert, Havkost, Sharon Lockhart, and many others. And she's a contribution editor of Art Forum magazine. Katie has also curated many, many exhibitions, and her exhibitions include Painting Paintings, David Reed, 1975, which she co-organized with the artist Christopher Wool, Light Years, Jack Whitten, 1971 to 1974, The Matter That Surrounds Us, Vols, and, you know, Charlene von Heil, and High Times, Hard Times, New York Painting, 1967 to 75. She's also a co-curator of Mark Bradford's installation of the American Pavilion, at the American Pavilion in Venice, which we are also looking forward to seeing next year in Venice. And I should say that Katie has been, again, an incredible, you know, colleague over the last, you know, 3 years that we worked on this project. And again, we're so grateful to have Katie here. Following Katie is the distinguished New Delhi-based critic and curator, Geeta Kapoor. I think we've all learned so much from Geeta's work, her example, not only just as a curator. I think it's really, in my view, if I may, important to say that to say that Geeta is a critic and curator doesn't quite do justice to the position she occupies, especially in the field that we are talking about today, in the field of trying to broaden the narrative of the modern, but also deep, Geeta's deep political, commitment, and that these two things are not separate, cannot be separated. So Geeta has published extensively in many anthologies, and her books include contemporary Indian artists, K.G. Subramanian, and a book that, for many of us has been an important touchstone, When Was Modernism? Essays on Contemporary Cultural Practice in India. And her book, Critics' Compass, Navigating Practice, is forthcoming. Geeta was a founder director of the Journal of Arts and Ideas in New Delhi and member of the Advisory Council of Third Text for many years. She's also trustee advisory editor of the journal Marg, which has been published now for nearly 70 years continuously, and editorial advisor of At Margins, curatorial projects. Her curatorial projects include Dispossession at Johannesburg Biennale in 1995, Bombay, Mumbai, the section of Century City at Tate Modern, Subterrane, at House of Kusturian de Veld in Berlin, Aesthetic Bind in Mumbai. She lectures internationally and has held visiting fellowships at the Institute for Advanced Study, Shimla, and Nehru Memorial Museum and Library in New Delhi, Clare Hall at the University of Cambridge, as well as the Nehru University, New Delhi. Finally, there's another introduction I'll make. Is Chico Keke. Chico Keke is Associate Professor of Art History at Princeton University and editor of UNCA, Journal of Contemporary African Art. He has co-organized several art exhibitions, including the Nigerian Pavilion at the first Johannesburg Biennale in 1995, and was one of the curators of a very important exhibition in 95 as well, Seven Stories About Modern Art in Africa, the Whitechapel Art Gallery, and the co-curator of the Short Century Independence and Liberation Movements in Africa, 1945 to 94, which kicked off here in Munich many years ago, and Who Knows Tomorrow, the exhibition at the Neue Nationale Gallery in Berlin. His books include Contemporary African Art Since 1980, Who Knows Tomorrow, and most recently, Postcolonial Modernism, Art and Decolonization in 20th Century in Nigeria. In 2016, Chika was awarded the College Art Association Frank Jewett Madder Award for Distinction in Art Criticism. And Chika is a columnist for the Huffington Post and a blogger at Ofodoka. And finally, my colleague Ulrich Wilmes, the chief curator of Haus de Kunst, will join us in the roundtable. Without much further ado, Katie, please, thank you.
Post-war proposes something terribly obvious at first sight, to present the art made around the world at the moment when the modern world as we know it came into being. So we keep asking ourselves, why has no museum done this before? We were just talking about that in the back of this room before we all sat down. Most obviously, there's this enormous amount of work that's required, the number of loans from places around the world, and exhibitions usually look at a single part of the world in monographic studies or in focus studies of a particular region, and then the loans all come from that area. But here, we were looking all over the world. So all of the logistics and the pragmatics make it very difficult. And the enormous amount of collective work that went into the research for this exhibition included not only the curatorial team here, but speakers at two international symposia, the 36 catalog authors, you'll hear a lot of numbers tonight, and the countless scholars, critics, authors, artists, curators, families of artists who built the knowledge base, a kind of informal archive that we relied on throughout the process of post-war. It sounds a bit funny, but I was thinking about this, and in a way, this collective work that we've done with all of these people, some of them long gone now, is a kind of dimension of knowledge production that was really born with the atomic bomb, where you have the modern version of scientific knowledge and really enormous synthetic production that happens with large number of peoples collaborating around the world. And out of the bomb comes the internet, but also these large projects that produce truly new and broad ideas. The other reason that this show has not been done before is that it depends on what is a very difficult idea. Taking seriously not only the existence, but the equal importance of multiple viewpoints, experiences, and positions around the world. This seemingly obvious, even bland idea turns out to be highly ideological, itself a new idea for Western museums and intellectual workers in the humanities, although it's obviously gaining more and more traction. Although sometimes I think single artists are picked up from the non-West more almost out of market interest than taking seriously that these artists are of equal importance. And so we were looking through the research ephemera last week down in the basement of the Haus der Kunst and still finding new things and complaining that we hadn't had time to read them. And Daniel Milnes, who's an assistant curator here at the museum and one of the team, said something consoling to me. He offered that the depth of post-war was its breadth. And I think this is a beautiful way to state this. This enormous project, this enormous interview overview and bringing together the real discoveries come out of those relationships, like Okwi said, and bringing this work together. It's an act of open eyes and of equality. It also changes the way we see history. It's not about adding names and art objects, and adding those names, it never stops there. It changes a context, it unsettles the categories and concepts, it never leaves them intact, it renders a new picture. And I guess I want to emphasize, like Okwi, it's not just a picture, it's a moving picture, because these things are in relationship to each other, and there is no single subject and single object position, but they are always changing and exchanging. So when we thought about, okay, we're going to take this big project on and how to organize the exhibition, we obviously considered, first of all, doing it by region or by nation, but rejected this concept very quickly in favor of a schematic or thematic structure. And this is reflecting something that maybe Chica will talk about later, or we talk about in the roundtable, a sort of shift in the humanities, a shift in academic study, away from area studies, which is itself seen now as a product of the post-war era, something funded largely by Western governments looking to produce intelligence and knowledge of other places like Russia that would help in diplomatic and intelligence relationships. And so there are a lot of younger scholars who've been engaged for the last 10 or 15 years, and how else can we think of things besides by region? So as Okwi said, we divided this into 8 chapters or themes to make an argument, and I will touch on those 8 chapters tonight. But I also wanted to mention 4 structuring relationships that go throughout the show. One is that we see the world as the whole world, and really for the first time. A lot of people argue about when globalization started, and people go all the way back to the ancient world, or they go back to the beginnings of capitalism and the industry of slavery and the and international trade. But with the use of the atomic bomb, two things happen. One, it's the first image that's seen around the world by 95% of people, according to sociologic polls in the 50s. So more people recognize the atomic bomb than Donald Trump, you know, or any sort of celebrity that you can think of. Everyone had seen this image. In the catalog, you'll find fascinating images from the around the world of the atomic bomb. But also, as Sukarno said in the opening of Bandung in Indonesia, the Bandung Conference in 1955, we no longer have the oceans to protect us. We are no longer isolated. We are in relationship to each other because of the atomic bomb. And because, he says presciently, of ecological destruction, that we are really one place. So that's one thing, we're one world. Two, that it is a world filled with antagonistic splits, most famously the Cold War between the US and Russia, but also fighting between the US and Western Europe over control of the West, between the traditional and the modern, the indigenous and the classical. So there are all kinds of dualistic splits. The third thing is autonomy, and you have the autonomy of individual nations in Nations Seeking Form, one of the chapters, where individual nations come to sovereignty and self-rule for the first time, and also a stress on the autonomy of individuals, famously, in the modern world. And the fourth kind of structuring historical view in the exhibition is the transnational. So connections and affinities that are chosen or imposed or inherited across national boundaries, pan-Arab connections, Bandung, pre-modern affinities that might be ethnic or religious, the forced or chosen movement of people, so the transnational connection. So these are the things structuring this new picture, and overall this idea of relation pulls the whole thing together. So why begin in 1945? 1945 is the end of the Second World War. It's the conventional place to begin this story. From the early exhibitions, documenta exhibitions of the 1950s through to today's art history textbook, begin with this year, classes in the university. Almost immediately, however, the proposition begins to become complicated. This year was first chosen because exhibitions and art making and art exhibiting started after a very traumatic period, a blind spot in European history, the period that the Haus der Kunst has dealt so ably with, as addressed in Ulrich Wilmes's essay. And documenta obviously looked to begin in 1945 rather than dealing with the art the war years, and connected back to an earlier modernism, to Kandinsky and Klee and Miro, to more recent German and French art. And the French exhibitions did much the same. Although the Second World War, as it's called in the West, and this is also highly contested, many nations around the world do not accede to the idea that this was a global war, a world war. People call it a civil war, a local war, and they say, look, South America, we did not participate in it, or China points to 1949 as the important year, not to 1945. But thinking of it as a global condition puts particular emphasis on Europe and its concerns, and art histories and exhibitions after the war persisted in this. Germany in particular seeking a fresh start after the war. The very first histories of the post-war period continued this pattern, including the United States as a relatively minor player, one among 13 nations, for example, in the first since 45 textbook or overview. So there are 12 European nations, and the United States is just one other nation. But soon the triumph, as it's known, of America as a geopolitical power was accompanied by the increasing artistic importance and political promotion of its artists, as in the New American Painting exhibition, which toured 8 European countries, accompanied by the Jackson Pollock retrospective. Many histories and exhibitions since the late 1970s and still today attack this political promotion of the US government of the artists, emphasizing a Cold War struggle not between the East and West, but between the US and European nations over leadership of the West. So this is a Michel Tapie show that sort of paired European and U.S. artists confronting each other and sort of battling it out for who was better, and critics were always arguing who was Pollock better Riopelle, who is the real sort of king of art. But I think this is a mistake. Fixating on this loses in this account the actual role of artists, their own political attitudes, imposing on the artists, whether they're French, Italian, German, American, the nationalist politics of their governments, who use their cultural products to advertise national importance. It's particularly odd in the case of the US artists in these shows, so many of whom were immigrants, African Americans, Jews, women with a complicated relation to the notion of America. So these American artists themselves are cosmopolitan, and Lee Krasner, for example, we have her best work, I think, the best work she ever did, is in the show, and borrowed from the Whitney Museum. She hated the Whitney Museum. She felt, as a Jew, their emphasis on a strident nationalist position at the Whitney Museum of American Art left her out. So she would not have been happy with this and the place for her painting. So we're presented with the problem, how to think about politics and art together and to do it globally. One answer to both questions has to been to revisit the question of what the end of the war meant around the world. And so perhaps the most obvious action of post-war has been to make Japan central to the understanding of 1945. And here is the Maruki's painting, one of the panels downstairs that Okui mentioned. How can we talk about the end of the war and the use of the atomic bomb without beginning here at ground zero, a story of destruction equally important to the ruin of Europe? We often speak of nuclear anxiety and imagination, which indeed traverse the globe, but here was reality. This is a photograph taken in Nagasaki soon after the atomic bomb was dropped. So the first section, Aftermath, takes an event so large and awesome that it had global implications, as if it belonged equally to all places in the world, and underscores its specificity and its physical reality. This dialectic between the universal and the local is one of the main structural elements of the post-war period and of our exhibition. The other very strong re-understanding of the meaning of post-war for us has been that decolonization was clearly equal in importance to the struggle between the US and the USSR. This is clear in recent histories, not art histories, but history, plain old regular history, from which we took a number of cues. It's in the apt term of a scholar of Algeria, one must take off the Cold War lens in order to see the world situation clearly. The end of the war, with the economic defeat of European powers, of the Allied as well as of the Axis, also rang the death knell for older forms of colonialism. Although resistance to colonialism could be found throughout its history, of course, now these battles begin to be won. New nations were founded, and art and culture was often deeply imbricated with the new states, as artists sought to create representations of independence and also became involved in civic institutions, art schools, even government positions. And we have devoted a section to such images called Nation-Seeking Form. This raises the perpetual question, how much does art reflect politics? There are many specific and different answers to this question. In the past, it's really been answered one way or another, but here we're looking at the choices that individual artists make and the different conditions in different countries. In this period, politicians and critics, as I've said, often made nationalist claims using art. Far more interesting are the actual claims by artists, the belief in participation in independence movements and new nations. So Ben Nwanwu said it succinctly and directly, my aim was to symbolize our rising nation. In Going from the exhibition, painted in the first year of Nigerian independence, Nwanwu emphasizes African tradition and imagery with masks, figures, and textiles from regions across the continent, including Liberia, Cameroon, and Mali. He celebrates Nigeria and also Pan-African identity. Hamed Awais celebrates Egyptian sovereignty in his Nasser and the nationalization of the canal of 1957, showing the Egyptian president issuing the directive to take back the Suez Canal, rejecting British imperialism and raising money for the projects of national self-interest, including the Aswan Dam. So it's complicated because there are things that seem very positive and things that are more fraught. So the twinned formation of Israel, here shown in the Johann and Simon painting and in several other works downstairs, is deeply connected to the destruction of Palestine, another direct, and these are both, of course, direct outcomes of World War II. the direct critique of America from within, the struggle of African Americans to change the racist system, was strongly represented by many artists. And here is a painting by Jack Winton called Birmingham, 1964, and a sort of burnt and distressed surface is torn open and reveals underneath it the Charles Moore photographs of the Birmingham protests and the police action in Birmingham underneath. As with Nwanwu's Pan-Africanism, here was a nationalist sentiment with transnational implications, as Witten and many of the other artists used popular photographs that of these protests that were directed around the world to countries that the U.S. sought to impress with its version of freedom amidst a Cold War struggle for the allegiance of the Third World. So these photographs were sent and to countries around the world, including African countries whom the United States was seeking to make economic relationships with. And that pressure, when you read the diplomatic papers, there's real alarm in the US government, fear that the African nations will see these pictures and won't believe them, won't trust them as economic partners as well. They shouldn't have. But this is something that the national is clearly tied with the transnational. And there's a lot of interesting history about the Cold War as really imbricated with the Third World. It's not an issue of eradicating, as Okwi said, the Cold War focus of earlier scholarship, but putting it into proportion and even more in active relation within a bigger picture. So the Cold War split has been extensively explored as it manifested in Germany in the split between East and West in the work of Eckhard Gillen and many others. The larger Cold War struggle, however, between the US and the USSR and China, as well as the condition of Poland, North Korea, and other countries, have been the subject of much new scholarship, beginning with the release of documents in 1989, but has been less often the subject of exhibitions. The communist regimes had mandates for political representations and acceptable subject matter depicting powerful leaders and model citizens. Those mandates fluctuated, however. In the so-called thaw after the death of Stalin, Soviet painting had a range of styles, including severe and more romantic work, reaching back to 19th century Russia. The art in the popular democracies of Eastern and Central Europe was much less regulated and more varied. Artists like Ivo Gotten engaged material abstraction, while others, such as Wroblewski, incorporated expressive and surrealist elements into their social subjects. So something that could have been very much a subject of socialist realism takes on a much more personal and strange expression. In China, during Mao Zedong's 100 Flower campaign, artists were allowed more flexibility. Traditional Chinese ink painting techniques were not uniformly suppressed, where they were sometimes forbidden and sometimes allowed, depending on the content and the individual artist. So you can't see the whole, this is one case, and there are many cases in the show where somebody sent us an image, a JPEG, and we didn't see the full work and its presentation. So this, very interestingly, is an enormous scroll painting. It's based on a much more traditional format. And Mao sometimes allowed younger artists, not older artists, but younger artists to use more traditional styles. Art by communist artists also appeared in the work of many socialist artists in the West, such as André Fougeron, Renato Guttuso, who you see here in the very funny boogie-woogie, sort of making fun of the bohemian indulgence of the young modern Westerners in front of Mondrian's Broadway Boogie Woogie, Boris Teslitsky and Alice Neal. And so one of the most fascinating, and so we wanted to look at socialist and communist artists in the West and say this is not exclusive to the East. And one of the most fascinating things, aspects of reading so broadly and looking so broadly throughout the post-war period has been the name of David Siqueiros popping up over and over again, not only educating communist artists in China and Russia, but appearing as an important presence for artists as varied as An Kawara and Inji Aflatun. So his name came up over and over again, and that was a surprise. On the other side of the divide of the Cold War, a competing version of modern life and freedom sat what has most commonly been called abstraction, in the section we have called Form Matters. Perhaps even more clearly, In this section, looking at the larger picture allows us to see affinities between what is going on around the world and also to unsettle what is a seemingly absolute category. This means seeing artists usually categorized as abstract expressionist, like Joan Mitchell, and informel, like Valls, labels that the critics adored, but almost all of the artists hated. So there was only one abstract expressionist artist who liked this label, and Valls and Fautrier both repudiated the label informel, something that does not always come up in exhibitions. So putting these artists together, even if critics of the moment like to put them in conflict, has allowed us to see commonalities and connections together as well with artists from around the world, some who did choose to work collectively, including Chiraga of the Gutai and Mohan Samant, and many more others, including Vladimir Budnik and Marcos Gregorian. It's an enormous room. It's packed with work. And very exciting to see, thanks to the architects we work with, to see it in such active, dynamic relation. Seeing these artists together puts in perspective the artwork coming from New York, that it's not so dominant when you look at it. It belongs to a global interest and a global conversation. About what is that conversation? The idea of the modern, to be sure, here in a new form, not the European ideological modern of geometric abstraction, which is addressed in a different section. But of gestural materialism. But it also allows us to rethink materiality away from a very provincial account of form as pure formalism. There is no purity in post-war. It's something that artists make strong statements against over and over again. This idea of formalism as a Western ideology or a belief in form that is devoid of content, again propagated by art critics, who I'm going to give a hard time to tonight, most famously Clement Greenberg, and not the artists themselves. Most of these artists refuse the concept of absolute abstraction, finding the term not useful. So we have substituted any number of ideas or filled the form with content in the essays that you'll read in the catalog, including most notably the subcategory of ruins and refuse, where you have Bury, whose work speaks of the trauma of war, Antonio Berni, whose work speaks of the waste of industrial capital and the poverty of the southern nations, and also, as Nikki de Saint-Phalle, a gleeful anarchic destruction of old orders. Many of the others in this section refuse the exclusive association between the modern and the European or American. Lee Sung-taik used in many other works traditional Korean weight measures as well as earthenware fermentation vessels to make sculpture, returning to a moment before the Japanese occupation of Korea. So this is artists posing this tradition in the modern as a false choice. Aimé Césaire wrote during this period, in other terms, we are summoned, choose between fidelity and backwardness or progress and rupture. And many artists, including those in the show, saw abstraction not as a product of the modern, but rooted in traditional aesthetics and impulses, or even as a universal need. As you see in Lydia Clark's Bichos, her animals that are down there in the exhibition, ready to be manipulated, many, like Clark, saw a human right to be related to belong to the material or natural world, to be temporarily liberated from social control and even from the confines of one's own self, in contrast to the assertion of the ego we associate with the modern. So you would find a connection to these objects, to these little animals that would take you out of yourself. Many other artists in here is David Madala with Gustav Metzger, who's also in the show at the Signals Art Gallery in London, and his Cloud Canyon, which he saw as a vitalist work, an animist work, and saw material and matter as alive, as having almost their own consciousness. This interest in materiality, which Geeta Kapoor writes about so beautifully in the catalog, led many artists to refuse altogether the choice between abstraction and figuration. Their number would include German artists such as Gerhard Richter and Georg Baselitz, who themselves had moved from east to west, had been instructed in both styles and their corresponding ideologies, and found the choice absurd and also seriously destructive. The battle between communist and capitalist ideologies, socialist realism and dogmatic abstraction gave rise to the idea of a lost middle ground, a missing center of feeling and expression where humanity should reside. Among the most famous events inspired by the situation were the 1951 Darmstadt Conference, 1950 Darmstadt Conference, Das Menschenbild in unserer Zeit, the image of man in our time, which featured the abstract artist Willy Baumeister, as well as the conservative art historian Hans Sedlmayr, and an audience that included Theodor Adorno amidst the other luminaries. And also the 1959 MoMA exhibition, New Images of Man, from which we get our title. One of the revelations of the research for post-war has been how widespread, how worldwide were the discussions of the new man, including the Tokyo Roundtable toward a new human image in 1955, in which Taro Okamoto participated, and this is an early performance piece where he attacks the figure, and art critical debates in London, Frank Auerbach here, the publications of essays in cultural journals like Présence Africaine and El Adab in Syria, and the formation of an artist group in Buenos Aires called Otra Figuración. Artists sometimes figured this new man even as female, and we tried our best to have images of women and work by women in the exhibition, and also people of color. Many of the artists in the show aggressively pushed together abstraction and representation, interrupting human images with lumps of oil paint, metal objects, charcoal, sand, detritus, and gestural marks. They looked to materiality to see the positive side of the atomic bomb was the wondrous discovery of the atomic nature of life, the organic nature of life that underlies all of our differences and connects us all to the natural world. Ernest Mancoba saw that the division between abstraction and figuration was symptomatic of all the problems of modernity. He said, our history has brought about, little by little, this dichotomy between abstraction and figuration, which provokes more and more a terrible atomization in the very essence of life. In no domain, more than in the arts, has this systematic dichotomy caused such destruction of the very foundation to the human identity. Adding these artists and images to the discourse is the historically correct thing to do, but it also fundamentally changes the questions being asked and the answers being given about the human condition. While a lot of this work flowed from Jean-Paul Sartre's existentialist writing, which pitted the individual against faceless social forces, many of these discussions brought in new and specific traditions, such as a humanism embodied in a cultural tradition stretching back to ancient Sumeria, taken up in Baghdad by artist Jawad Salim, who is looking to Sumerian sculpture. There are also many images of thinking man by Sousa, by Ankawara, here's Ankawara, and by Makbul Hussein, asserting that the right to contemplation, to conceptualization, did not lie solely with the West. And in fact, the West seemed to have abrogated the right to define the human, the moral right. As Fanon said, this Europe, which never stopped talking of man, which never stopped proclaiming its sole concern was man, we now know the price of suffering that humanity has paid for every one of its spiritual victories. And he might have been speaking for Gerard Sokoto, whose prison yard condemns not some vague idea of humanity or man or society, but specifically European colonization. So it's not a vague sort of transcendent or universal idea, but a very specific critique. So to assert that what has once been seen as emphatically local, in fact, defined a universal or an ideal, inverted the old order of things. Along with this overturning goes a cascade of other assumptions. The dualistic category of form and content, too, depends on the opposition of universal versus local, West versus non-West, and demanded that an artist choose a single mode. What an art historian might understand as an unanswerable question about style, which style do you choose, was experienced by artists as an impossible demand that the artist choose between social and artistic identity. As when Iba Ndiaye spoke of the pressure on artists to be Africans before being painters or sculptors. Succinctly describing this conceptual structure as one that divides art into form, which is learned and borrowed from the West, and on the other hand, content, whose raw material is abstracted from national cultures. Art historian Shiva Balagi finds this dilemma at the root of a 40-year-old question in her field. Is this art modern, and is it Iranian? And the very first time I ever heard Okwi speak, I think in 2000, he was addressing, is this art African, and is this art modern? So it was a nice memory for me when I was writing this talk. This, too, is obviously a false choice. Perhaps the greatest revelation of moving post-war from an idea, from emails and conferences and images and reading, to a reality and unpacking the artwork, has been the revelation of just how good this art is, how beautifully made it is. That if the material work in Four Matters is filled with real feeling and content, the reverse is true. The representational work is gorgeous, meticulously crafted, experimental, made with intent, purpose, and intent. So I hope everyone recognized this when they went through the show and took great pleasure in it. This at-onceness of form and content is clearly on display in the art that Iftikhar Dadi and Salah Hassan have called calligraphic abstraction. One reason why this category has been so compelling as a description is that it allows for communication that is both social and shared, and also expresses a feeling, a state of being, that is so specific it needs to be physically experienced as a line, a color, a texture. This art, which we feature in cosmopolitan modernisms, like that of Concrete Poetry, and also the communication section, and this is a work by Mohamed Melehi, part of a group of international artists who believe that information and cybernetic information could be conveyed by abstraction. This work traces transnational affinities and experiences, experiences that move between colony and metropole as these artists move between a home or a school and career in London or Paris, belonging in both places or sometimes neither, and affinities across national boundaries. So this is another member of the group. From Eastern Europe to South America, speaking to shared cultural and religious identities and also to philosophical interests. Talking of the pressure for talking of the pressure for art to be social, to respond to a popular audience, Mohamed Kadas summarizes many of these concerns in a magisterial essay called Towards a New Art. He's talking of the pressure for art to be social and respond to a popular audience. He says, a people is not one thing. Their tastes and their needs are multiple. And this is one of the paintings that got away, by the way. We all had things that we wished so desperately we could have gotten, and we worked so hard, and this is a painting I regret not seeing in person. He criticized socialist realism. He also criticized modern art regulated by capital and its laws, and said in the West that artists only had a relative liberty. They were dependent on the upper class and fitting into its apartments. But he said, don't condemn easel art for this, but aspire to other larger possibilities. He talks about the treasures of our culture, the enigmatic frescoes of Ticili, pottery, tapestries, calligraphy, the miniature. But he says it would also be a mistake to ignore black art across the West since 1900, Aztec art, Siqueiros in his prison, the calligraphy of the Far East, and even the American artists satirizing and rejecting the American way of life. Unlike the Western avant-garde model of history, there's not a single line of progress for Kada that leaves everything previous invalidated. He says, the revolutions in art, they don't destroy, they accumulate. There's a piling up, a layering of incredible richness. Just a few years earlier in 1955, at that roundtable I mentioned, Ankawara spoke in similar, if less ecstatic terms in occupied Japan, of the condition of history in Japan. He said, at the same time, feudal institutions and sentiments remain, the same time as monopoly capitalism, permeating every aspect of our life. I suspect that these different historical stages are layered. We cannot proactively change our reality unless we shed a westernized, monolithic viewpoint and accept these contradictions as autonomous subjects. Kada, writing from a newly free Algeria, was more upbeat. And it's from his essay that I take my title, that the history of painting is tied to the history of humanity. So what has come up again in conclusion, what's come up again and again throughout the process of post-war have been these, the coexistence of so supposedly opposed modes of existence, the traditional and the modern, the communist and the individual, abstraction and the non-ideological. The artists in post-war don't deny the choices offered, the actual conflicts and divisions that exist, even if they exist solely in being legislated by society. But the reason that art does more than simply reflect the social is that it offers the possibility of experiencing, expressing, and also testing the nature of the conflict, of qualifying and nuancing the choices to be made, of choosing more than one side, or of simply not choosing at all. That is, refusing to perceive a conflict or contradiction between being Senegalese and being a painter, between being American and Jewish, between inheriting a tradition and living in a modern city, between collective and individual identity. Art also offers the possibility of rewriting the given names and terms, suggesting their obsolescence or inaccuracy, and offering one's own, of making history as well as of reflecting it. Thank you.
Not just an overview, as Katie kept saying, but it's a very comprehensive and substantial investigation, which the exhibition does, of course, which we have seen and understood, but which in this compressed form Katie was able to present to us. It's an extraordinary range of ideas as well. I have a more limited or more focused position for today, which is probably due to the kinds of preoccupations that I have had before, but also because the very fact of the comprehensiveness, the largeness, the enormity of the project made me want to actually focus on some few issues, which I hope will be provocative in some ways. I want to start by speaking about what I understand to be the curatorial method. And this is, of course, an extrapolation from before seeing the exhibition, from the kind of literature and images that was being sent to me because I was one of the writers, and now after seeing the exhibition. The massive exhibition curated by Okwi Envizor, Katie Siegel, and Ulrich Wilms is premised on the material history of the post-war decades, 1945-65. More specifically, the exhibition intervenes in the discipline of art history and with the established itineraries relayed by museums. I should have mentioned that I call my short paper Recursive Narrative, Ways of Producing Art History. Almost 400 artworks from around 60 countries are divided into 8 themes. We've already been explained that in some detail. What I want to emphasize is that they are placed on some kind of a level ground. This might assume a community of artists settled within the broad parameters of modernism. But in fact, on the other hand, the exhibition compresses this inclusive history to a degree that it implodes and lays bare uneven terrain, disparate sites, conditions, and means of art production. In continuation with this, with his other major curatorial interventions, Okwi Envizor will have begun, I imagine, this project with a declared methodology for historical investigation first and foremost, and a political position that is partisan but not sectarian, committed yet comprehensive. And I extrapolate on these terms as I understand them to operate in this project. To refuse a historicist account, yet historicize against the grain. That is, to historicize through a recursive narrative. To disrupt the recursive rhythm by marking disjunctures, and to construct an art history from this disjuncted material. to structure the exhibition as a field of inquiry and as a series of encounters, and convert the phenomenological experience into discourse, but to then return to the artworks, to the means and materials of production and practice, the materialist undergridding, and I am using the word materialist in very specific terms for those who will recognize its genesis in Marxism, the materialist undergridding of this historical method, but without an overdetermining the aesthetic. The curators have paid close attention to the particularities of the image form, which allows them to give, of course, due regard to figurative and abstract, material and conceptual, avant-garde and rear-garde artworks. The war and its aftermath are, of course, a theme which has been visited in philosophy, literature, and the arts for most of the 20th century. The Holocaust and the war devastates Europe, Britain, and the USSR. This is history engraved with trauma. Its expression in philosophy and the arts, including especially literature and cinema, is profound. Modernity now shapes an ontology around trauma and offers it as the universal language of post-war modernism. Another aftermath takes place in Japan and in Asia. The surrender of fascist Japan, the use of the atomic bomb by the USA, Hiroshima, Nagasaki, the death and mutilation of generations of the Japanese. The war ends in 1945, or what we consider to be the event of the Second World War ends in 45, but all of Asia burns with wounds inflicted by the Japanese Empire and the persistence of Western powers now seeking to alleviate their war-torn economies through colonial extraction until they have to withdraw more or less within 10 to 15 years of the end of the war. Decolonization and civil wars go together. A very large number of countries of Asia and Africa gain their independence between 45 and 65. This is partly precipitated by the war. By inducting colonized populations in Asia and Africa into the war, for example, a volunteer Indian army of 2.5 million soldiers are recruited to fight for the Allies. Europe ignites further resistance through this process of induction. The 1942 Quit India call issued to the British by Gandhi-led Congress sets the pace for Indian independence in 47. While the post-war period must be memorialized for a quickening of the decolonization process, it also stirs up internal violence all across Asia. Territorial conflicts, civil wars between nationalists and communists, intercommunal massacres take place across Asia. Consider just for a moment the one of the most horrific examples. The states of India and Pakistan separate at the very moment of independence or become nations at the very moment of their declared independence. 200,000 or more people are massacred and 14 million displaced. One of the largest mass migrations in human history at the eve of independence of both India and Pakistan in 46-47. As African countries gain independence in quick succession in the 1960s, the continent is engulfed with wars against the colonizers, especially the French and the Portuguese, but acted out in territorial and ethnic massacres as well, coups and civil wars between and within the newly defined nations. The Cold War. In a world so fraught and turbulent, the rise of superpower, the US-led NATO coalition and the USSR-led socialist bloc is almost as if foretold. equipped with nuclear weapons, the Cold War players congeal into bitter hostility and hold the world hostage. In West Asia, the mapping of Israel is undertaken in 1948 by an Anglo-European mandate. Its subsequent militarization with US help dispossesses Palestine the more and involves one Arab country after another. The Six-Day War in 1967 continues to mutate across the Arab world into intestine conflict, wars of attrition between and for Islam. The conditions of West Asia from the 1960s accelerates to tragic proportions and defies comprehension. In Asia, the tearing apart of North and South Korea is contiguous with the wars in Indochina. Vietnam, of course, stands for this entire process of is emblematic of the operations of the Cold War. In the hands of US imperialism, which is ready to annihilate a small peasant country with weapons of mass destruction. Ravaged for almost two decades, Vietnam defeats America with help from China and Russia, of course, but with unimaginable courage and suffering of its own people. Vietnam is a miracle of the third world. USA's super imperialism is at its most belligerent in Latin America, supporting military or right-wing coups, staging a parade of puppet regimes that suppresses revolutionary movements across the continent. The Third World. Given the Cold War, post-independence solidarity among the new nations was forcefully predicated. Pan-Asian, Pan-Arab, and Pan-African dreams now developed into the larger Afro-Asian conference attended by 29 newly independent countries. The Bandung Conference, April 1955, is hosted by Sukarno of Indonesia and has a strong Southeast Asian tenor. Despite ideological difference, even Zhou Enlai attends the conference. Bandung develops into the Non-Aligned Movement, NAM, in 1961, led by India's Jawaharlal Nehru, along with Sukarno, Nasser of Egypt, Nkrumah of Ghana. This time, Tito of Yugoslavia hosts the conference in Belgrade. Representatives of 25 countries from all across Asia and Africa participate. NAM then becomes the political face of the Third World. Thence the Tricontinental Conference in Havana in 1966, the largest ever solidarity conference of the peoples of Asia, Africa, and Latin America, termed OSPAAAL. 500 representatives from some 82 countries, including independent governments, national liberation movements, leftists, and guerrillas. This is an emphatically anti-imperialist congregation, and amongst the delegates are Fidel Castro, Salvador Allende, and Cabral. Che Guevara sends a rousing message. The first phase of independence, the new nations claim to sovereignty are best realized through the constitution of democratic republics. Governments of the new nation states commit to carry out planned development and infrastructural modernization in the name of the people. The people often who are referred to or inducted into the process of development are seen in at least two immediately signifiable ways. One is a more communitarian understanding of what the new nation must do with its people, and the other is a more statist decision to be a more statist structure whereby modernization can take place at a more systematic and progressivist mode. This is realized with different levels of success all across the world, or the third world. The pledge of decolonization is a promise of sovereignty. Let me suggest its alternative rendering as in India. From where I speak more confidently, modernity is framed by the poet Rabindranath Tagore in universal non-nationalistic terms. Gandhi's ethics of non-violence resistance, civil disobedience, and rightful citizenship is posited in anti-modern and anti-state terms. Nehru's modernity is progressivist and premised on a principle of a developmental nation-state. The jurist Ambedkar, who writes the Indian Constitution, makes self-determination an insurrectionary claim for the caste-oppressed population of India. I give this as an example to suggest that decolonization and the claim to sovereignty had within it some of the most complex contradictions and gives to these nations an ability to both theorize and practice the needs of modernity and modernization, and then finally, in art, terms of art, modernism in extremely complex ways, if you consider only this little compressed history of what happens from the 1920s in India until the 1950s and early 60s. The ethical lapse of the actual Third World, the Third World Project, must, however, be admitted. There is, within a decade, a dissipation of democratic mandates, hardening of revolutionary energies, and recurrence of repressive dictatorships. There is indifference towards the Afro-Asian solidarities, rejection of NAM, and of any common platform that spells even strategic autonomy, leave alone non-aligned solidarity. A recent generation of post-colonial theorists repudiates even the founding optimism of Bandung, the non-aligned movement, and tricontinentalism. To my mind, only the most cynical evaluations will claim that the Solidarity Project, as well as the national developmental models, were from the start mistakenly conceived. Like liberation struggles, the degree and kind of modernization is now, of course, subject to more precise critique due to hindsight. But also, if I might say so, because on account of the fact that this debate is totally subsumed by, there is a subsumption of all options by global capital. Therefore, the critique in retroactive critique is in some ways very punctual to the needs of global capital. Realpolitik, ideology, and discursive revaluation need to be deployed with due regard for the historical condition in which choices are made, whether utopian or pragmatic. The Third World as a trope. Thus, in my argument, the Third World is not mere deduction from the bilateral Cold War, nor false ideology. It is a political alternative in the form of a trope. In its precipitate moments, the Third, then, is dialectically driven. As, for instance, when pre-colonial traditions are recalibrated to claim diverse styles of cultural modernity. And just a few examples. The politics and practice of negritude, formulated by the Caribbean poet Césaire and the African poet statesman Leopold Senghor, who virtually makes this a cultural mandate for Senegal and beyond. The startling concept of anthropophagy, a term translated as cannibalism by the Brazilian avant-garde in the 1920s and invoked thereafter as a conceptual trope to invert the shame projected upon the colonized and to radicalize the discourse around post-colonial identity. Civilization aura in pan-Arab imaginary with claims to rational and transcendent knowledge at once. And in Buddhist Southeast Asia, the sense of an immanent ethic that nurtures aesthetic sublimation of tradition, practical knowledge, and social judgment. Postcolonial counter-narratives then are so generative as to set the agenda for postmodernism as well. Consider Homi Bhabha's and the way he theorizes the subversion through inflected speech practiced by the colonized. Gayatri Spivak places the figure of the subaltern to refigure the idea of sovereignty within post-colonial nations. Stuart Hall and Sarath Maharaj speak about translation, where we look for a contextually shaped semantics. Dipesh Chakravarti, his thesis, Provincializing Europe, exemplifies the radical inversions by which postcolonial imagination reorders the world. People's movements, liberation struggles, and state formations after colonialism produce in almost all cases national allegories that are emancipatory as well as oppositional. The fault lines now form the fractured imaginary of the Third World. These can be interrogated but not erased. They take the form of a palimpsest where the aesthetic asks to be written into the political. The exhibition. An exhibition is a good place to embed a grid and plot the symmetries and asymmetries of figure, sign, and meaning. Consider what even some random paintings or some random examples of these hundreds of painterly exposition that we see here, what they do if we just pair them together for a very short period of attention. They suggest that there is, in the war-torn globality of mid-20th century, a transactional grammar at work which brings about formal parities within modernist practice, but also determined contrast at generic and ideological levels. I will now start the very short run of the slides. And I will not speak with these because they are paired for fairly apparent relationships and contrasts of the kinds of the kind of complexity and contradiction this exhibition is able to present. I'm more or less presuming that most of you have had at least one quick look at the exhibition and possibly more, so that these juxtapositions will be both apparent from the exhibition itself and from what I understand can be deduced from the kind of relationships. And I would urge you to look at the year and the dates of the works that I'm projecting, because they will give you, I think, almost immediately what I'm trying to say about both the formal parities as well as the generic and ideological differences between the works produced within a fairly close range of years. they said the date, the place they are made, and the range of preoccupations which coalesce in so many cases across this exhibition. That's it. I wanted to emphasize two parts of this exhibition, or rather to focus on just two parts. Katie has given an extraordinary overview and analysis of the actual works that have been included. And I wanted to emphasize two amazing conjunctions. Modernism's disjunctive template mirrors materiality and formalist otherness. In Gutai on the one hand, in Japan, and Brazilian New Concretism on the other. And Gutai in Japan through the 50s and 60s, and New Concretism over a longer period of time because it mutates into other forms like Tropicalia. And the engagement with both materiality and the anarchy of production, which would become almost paradigmatic for a period of modernism in outside of Europe. So it is paradigmatic because we understand materiality totally differently within this kind of a paradigm. And one could, of course, say much more about this. On another plane, the exhibition allows, I think, anachronistic retakes. Subsumed categories such as the indigenous, the national, and the diasporic asked to be relayed within post-war globality. Does the humanist premise, underlying European realism become an allegorized nation form in Mexico or in India? I'm thinking of Diego Rivera and M.F. Hussain, the latter represented here by a major early painting man that I showed a moment ago. So the point that we might, or the issue that we might discuss is that the languages, for instance, of humanism and realism in Europe might take on such a vision so different that it might involve an understanding of indigenous, national, and diasporic imaginaries, which may often be in contradiction of the modernist principle of art making. And so the very premise from which the artist works might undergo a mutation and a contradiction, and therefore an other kind of dialectical relationship with the language that is being used at any given time, whether modernist or realist. I'd like to emphasize some what I would think would be the politics and aesthetics, or the kind of conjunction that this exhibition proposes. Whether it is acknowledged or not, post-war modernism is a disjuncted template. If there was, until the mid-20th century, a sovereign status for modernist language, it is now pulled apart by a high count of radical derivatives from the elsewhere. The curators, as I have earlier suggested, appear to present a recursive narrative that pairs aspirational with material modes of creativity. This means the exhibition will focus on location, as in archaeology, shift paradigm, as in philosophy, and help to surface a phenomenological concept like heterotopia that speaks of other places, indeed, several other places. A globalized post-colonial consciousness, such as that Nwiza has very often presented in his prior exhibitions, is a lesson so brilliant that we might invite the equally brilliant art historians of the October group and their redoubtable book, Art After 1900, into some kind of a face-to-face. To seriously improvise That is to say, to seriously improvise on established theories of an avant-garde art. We have to open up a situational politics with dense cultural annotation that gives purpose to the key avant-garde dialectic, art and life. In my own case, real and imaginary dialogues with Rashida Rain, Gerardo Mosquera, Okwi Envisor, and my colleagues in India reinforces a retrospective, annotative, and projective art history that does not anymore fill the gap. It tracks other avant-gardes yet unmarked in 20th century art history. Part of an immense triptych, post-war, post-colonial, and post-communist, this exhibition is terrifyingly punctual. The post-war experience is today omnipresent. Citizenship is deterritorialized. Migrants and refugees must count as viable polity in countries not their own. There is demotic pressure of the dispossessed in a fully globalized and as equally dismembered world. Which kind of art will guide us into what Okwi Envisor calls the global public sphere? During 1997-98, Hans Hacker stepped into the Reichstag and intervened in 20th century history by installing a textual sculptural installation in its courtyard premise. He made an audacious amendment to the words that have adorned the portal: to the German people. Hacker's enormous rectangular cast spells in massive neon-lit words the message, the people. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Geeta. I think it's really a very provocative and wonderful way to begin this panel, because while Katie gave an overview of not only the exhibition, but what one would call the contest, not context, but the contest of ideas that surround the making of an exhibition of this nature in relation to historical work that have been done over many decades, and how to not only work from that historical context, but also to to contest that historical material. You spoke both in large terms about the social-political historical turns that bring us to the, very premise of post-war. But then you delve into the exhibition, and I'm very struck with what you began with, and I think it would be very important that we start with that. You talk about that the fact that the exhibition at some level implodes and lays bare uneven terrains. I think it's so beautifully put. And, because it's important that you said that, simply because the exhibition was not made to or meant to be to emulsify these differences, to kind of flatten out the ground. It is, in fact, that rupture that we are seeking. But I want you to maybe to talk a little bit about what you meant precisely about that, sense of implosion and the uneven terrain that you see emanating within the body of the show. I think that's really very instructive and very, to use your term, a very timely remark, to make.
Even before I had seen the exhibition, through the material that I was receiving because of the catalog and the every single image that is in the exhibition I had seen sent across to me by and the Haus der Kunst. It seemed that you were, the curators were establishing a kind of material density of visual image, but also of ideological difference. That was bound to this kind of a materialist-based understanding of art practice would not only displace other art historical paradigms, or that it would not simply challenge art historical paradigms or museum itineraries, but in actual fact, that materialist commitment to the work of art as a act of production was going to in some ways annotate annotate the aesthetic with the force of contradictions. So the aesthetic that would emerge from this would by no means ever be, it seemed to me, even before I came and certainly after I've seen the exhibition, that it would never allow for the one story of modernism, which we have questioned for many decades now, which we know to be the case, but that its phenomenology itself will make that difference an experiential difference.
Yeah. So that cut in the body of the show, Katie, talk a little bit about because you ended with Mohamed Kada, with Alphabet, Libre, and his essay about the task, of the artist within the kind of changing historical context of the post-war period, especially in relation to decolonization and so on, and then facing the massive rock that is the West and its power and so on. So how do you see this exhibition, working itself around this massive rock? Is it a confrontation with the rock? Does the boat crash into it and splinter into pieces? And I think that is the metaphor that the critic in Pseudo-Zeitung used. The metaphor of Humpty Dumpty being smashed, and not being put back together again. Does that metaphor make sense for this show?
I mean, I think the idea of uneven terrain and certainly the violence of what you say is an apt description of the confrontation with the modern for people around the world. I think that one of the things that comes out in Gita's paper is the violence of that history, and then what do you do with artists who are also excited by the modern, and so I feel like it's not uniformly violent in that sense, but that it is something that is more sedimentary and layered, and sometimes it's very varied. Sometimes there's enormous conflict and contradiction and impact, and then the artists find ways to take in what they want from the modern, and to find antecedents for the modern, that for abstraction that are not Western, like the neo-concrete artists who are looking at Max Bill, but they're also insisting on Torres Garcia from Uruguay in the 20s and 30s. So I think, and also to pre-modern traditions, to traditional practices and folk practices. So I think there's not a single answer, but the violence that Gita brings out is something that we shouldn't forget about that conflict.
I think the idea or the question that you ask about what do you do with the rock, I would like to think that, or at least the way I understand rocks as natural things, mm-hmm. I think we're dealing with not a natural phenomenon. You're mm-hmm. dealing with a history that mm-hmm. had been constructed. Mm-hmm. And the question is, what do you do with that history, mm-hmm. right? You find ways of demolishing it. Demolishing it might also involve a sort of epistemological violence, but not in the sense of a violence for its sake, but a kind of, in fact, regenerative violence. Because you're dealing, I think the point that Gita raised about what do you do with, you know, some of these monumental narratives of the modern that we have been left with, I think that's a way of referring to this rock, right? That projects like this necessarily confront. And the question is, in what ways might projects such as this deal with these monumental narratives that that we've inherited as scholars, as institutions, are grappling with, you know, this past, this history that in fact impacts the way that we work in the present. So it's not just simply about how the past has been constructed, but you know, the ways in which it impacts the work we still produce today as scholars, but also as institutions. And so what I think that this, that's why I really appreciate the fact that this is a historical project, right? We've seen instances in the past when projects try to imagine the global, but by looking at it in a contemporary sense, right? Yes. I think that this is the stuff of tremendous knowledge production, because it just goes to a time that is already past to ask us to rethink the past. And the moment that we come to terms with that, that this can be reimagined with all its warts, with all its inequivalences, you know, this uneven terrain that that we've been talking about. I think once we understand that this terrain does not need to be leveled out, as Opi suggests, then we come to it with less anxiety. Because I think that what has been the problem is the sorts of anxieties about even beginning the work of rethinking these you know, again, monumental narratives that we have. And it's not going to end anytime soon. But frankly, I am thrilled that, you know, that you guys, the curatorial team, had the courage, but also that you have an institution. Because I was saying to Okui, I cannot imagine any other institution where this project could have taken place and produced it in the way that it has. So it's very important that this has begun. There will be discussions, fraught, that will follow the show, but you know, let it happen.
Yeah.
Yes.
I think, you know, a number of things are emerging, you know, from this, and I think that one of the questions is this monumental history of modernism or of modern art, and maybe let's just simply say of Western modernism in this sense. So if my experience, and this question will go to Ulrich, because I think he knows this, you know, terrain much better than I do. My experience of going to museums in Germany and in many different cities, sort of looking at the collection, is that this big modern art history is itself deeply fragmented, mm-hmm. and also deeply provincialized internally. Mm-hmm. And so that when you go to Paris, for example, you know, you do not really see many German artists in there, or many British artists, really, quite frankly. And if you go to Centre Pompidou, it's very clear that they really ignored American art, mm-hmm. in a very deep way. They don't, you know. So, if you go to German museums, it seems that there are two moments, at least for museums that have modern art collection, is the, you know, the period of German New Expressionism, and then, you know, pop art, kind of, and it's sprinkling, but it's really true, and much of this collection has not actually been built by the institutions themselves, but you see there are collections that have come from individuals, private collections that have built them, and in a bid to fill the void, so many of these collections have been packed in museums as long-term loans. So can you really talk a little bit about, in Germany, how this so-called massive history fits the reality of what we actually see in the museums?
I think Oakwood is probably the best example of a German museum collection, as you described it, is probably the collection of the Museum Ludwig in Cologne. Because this is actually based on two major donations. The first was in 1946, that means immediately after the end of World War II, the donation of a major collection of German expressionist art by a lawyer called Haubrich, and it was on display in this year in the destroyed university. They found a space where they could safely show this collection. And this was, of course, a major gesture to do that after the war. And then Irene and Peter Ludwig, the major collectors, they started this pop art collection. And even the American museums are kind of jealous when they come to Cologne and see what is collected there. Because he started to collect this in a moment when American museums just were not interested in buy that stuff, so he had the good advisors, and that's why this collection came into being. But it shows that this civic engagement of individuals was, of course, very, very important, especially after the war. And thank you very much, Chica, for this. I take this as a huge compliment that you say Haus der Kunst is probably the only institution where a show like this can be shown. And when you are thinking about this, we were often discussing that in the preparation of the show, that the institution itself is a post-war institution. I mean, the pre-war and during the war history of Haus der Kunst was, of course, devoted to the German art, to the propagandistic use of art through the Nazis, but then immediately in 1946, the activity started again. First, to bring the modern art back to a German institution to show the people what they have lost, and also what the museum collection has lost. And this is another point, Oakley, for why German collections look as they look today, because there was, of course, a huge loss during the Nazi time that the modernist works were taken out of the collections and being sold and spread worldwide, and it was, of course, a major problem to reestablish concise collections after the war, which was probably impossible for many institutions. And but to come back, I mean, Haus der Kunst is an institution that offers a huge freedom of what you can do. And in the last days, when I spoke with many people who were walking through the exhibition, they kind of mixed up the expressions of exhibition and collection. So I often heard that they suddenly said, well, this is a brilliant collection.
That would be nice.
That, yeah. And I mean, this is something which is really, we can think about. I mean, this would really fit into many, many museums to have a collection like this exhibition offers.
Yeah, thank you. And please, you know, step in at any time, but Gita. Yeah.
This is in relation to what Chika said about the master narratives. Of course, there's been a very long discussion now within postcolonial and particularly subaltern aspects of subaltern ideology within postcolonialism about refuting the master narrative. I'd like to actually play this on another plane, like in as a devil's advocate. Now, supposing we were to accept that modernism does have a master grammar, and I would, over the years, having put myself to the task of repudiating it, I would like to actually start by accepting it, that there is a master grammar, but that the rules of the game of the master grammar are continually changed. In other words, there is a linguistic structure which modernism has. And it is in the changing the rules of the game are precisely what radical art or avant-garde is about. So the maneuvers that have taken place are not just a repudiation of the master narrative or the hitting the head against the rock, but there have been very many more subtler propositions. Similarly, I would even concede that there might be something like a political unconscious of the universal modernist, of universal modernism. That there does exist a political unconscious which actually is part of our consciousness itself. So the question would be that these are in some ways contested at very precise levels, not as dealing with the master narrative with a master counter narrative, but that these are very precise interventions. And I did not read one part. I'll just mention that I think it would happen at very many levels. This elsewhere, which produces this changing of the game, would be at the distributive economy of anthropologically supported sign systems corresponding to distinct cultural paradigms. It would be as metaphoric translation of the structures of feeling embedded in these paradigms. It would read as signals, or more aptly, agonistic gestures consciously positioned vis-a-vis mainstream Euro-American art. And this exhibition is punctual with such semiotic data. So it is, let us accept the fact that we are not necessarily making a counter-narrative, but that this exhibition would allow us to see what is the semiotic that emerges from this.
Yeah, I think that's, you know, precisely, is, I think, is a very, you know, important, devil's advocate role to, you know, to play, you know, because, you know, if I may paraphrase Homi Bhabha out of tune, when he said to repeat a stereotype is not to displace it. And I think maybe that what we mustn't do is to repeat the stereotype of this mass narrative as something that has to go into the junk heap of history. And therefore, by doing that, we are not able to displace, you know, precisely, you know, its overwhelming power. And this, in its overwhelming power, has also generated a certain kind of historical lapse in places that want to sort of to take possession of that power, say the United States, which I would argue until really the post-war period, you know, was also seen as provincial or was, you know, deeply provincialized. So these changing rules of the game, the rules of the game, as it were, would be what really made American art, so to speak, a dominant force in the post-war period. Now, the question is, how do we, you know, rethink the rules of the game? I tend to think of this, you know, our receptions of art in two ways. that is predicated, yes, the semiotics, the language of the artist, the kind of the master, you know, text of production, of invention, you know, which is something that, you know, cannot, you know, be denied. But I tend to think of it as a, you know, process of habituation, right? You know, through going to museums and, you know, seeing the way things are laid out, and, you know, it's an instruction. You know, it's, you know, the museum display is a strategy of instruction. Until you learn the language, until you become habituated to it. The second part of that is that, you know, the history of art is a history of its institutions in the West. And, you know, if you take, for example, what is now called classical music, you know, it is also predicated on its institutions. You know, the Philharmonic, the symphony, the opera, whatever. So these are its institutions. But that does not mean, so that really brings us up to the question, you know, how to deal with those kinds of practices that actually, you know, do not have that kind of precise language, you know, to nominate them into the rules of the game. And this is precisely the question of this exhibition. How would you go about doing, you know, changing the rules of the game? Any of you?
Yeah, I think that the way I see the problem is not too different from the kinds of questions that art history programs mm-hmm. are asking themselves. But also, if we think of the other arm of art knowledge production, which is publications, books, scholarly texts, in the way, in the first instance, the questions that you have in the Art 100, what's referred to as Art 100.
This is America, by the way.
In the United States.
This is in the United States. Let's be specific here.
Well, yeah. I'm coming to that. The introduction of introduction to art, whatever it's called in our programs, that introduces not just art history students, but any student who is interested in art. So you have this layout of the land, right, as it were, of the history. The moment that it comes to a crisis in art programs, in art history programs, and the kinds of questions that scholars in those programs are asking, how do you teach art history? At a moment when we've become utterly aware of the insufficiency of the ways in which it's been taught before. Now you have scholars who are producing books about artistic phenomena and histories that happened in different parts of the world. And we have access to these books, these publications. And how do we think about, how do we contend with these other narratives, right, that are in fact sometimes contemporaneous and so forth. And what has happened, as far as I can tell, at least in many American institutions, is the shift from telling, you know, this kind of genealogical story of art to one that deals with ideas that may connect different spheres, different landscapes.
You mean more comparative?
Not necessarily comparative. It's what I see in this exhibition, because I want to come back to why I think that this exhibition offers something that is radical, in the sense that it looks at a historical period, but it's looking at it through 8 different lenses. Now, that's not normal. If you go back and look at how we think of art history as successive events, because of the history that is attached to art history. Mm-hmm. But it's looking at it through themes, through thematic networks. And that's what's been happening in recent years. How do you teach Benin art and medieval art in Europe that happened, you know, around the same time, the same period? Are there ways of rethinking the way we talk about these things by not looking at them as islands, islands of artistic production, and then you have a problem with linking them, right? So I think that what has happened with an exhibition like this and the question about, is this about demolishing? No, but maybe that's what we eventually result from the kind of studies, the kinds of exhibitionary propositions such as this one is making in terms of how we think about the modern. That if eventually what happens is that narrative, that way of thinking about 20th century art ceases to make sense. I think that's what changing the paradigm looks like, right? It's still there, but it doesn't make as much sense anymore. And I seem to remember, finally, if you remember, we at the conference that led to this exhibition, one of the presenters who worked on Parisian art, I'm sure you guys remember that episode, sounded a bit apologetic for the kind of work that he did, right? Faced with, you know, the multiplicity. I'm not quite sure.
Go ahead.
I'm not quite sure if I, but that very moment for me was quite incisive, because this was the terrain that some of us on this table and elsewhere came to when the same kind of event would have been, I would have been the one apologizing for the material that I'm clutching, you know, under my arms. Or the artists and
yes.
So forth.
This is Serge Guibaud, I'll just say it, and because he is the person I'm implicitly criticizing in the talk.
Oh, I didn't know
about
that.
a focus on, and his work was important.
Yeah, sure.
So, but that
his book, it was titled How New York Stole the Idea of Modern Art from Paris. Yeah.
But the part of the problem is that, first of all, it doesn't look at the artists. It looks only at their use by the United States. Mm-hmm. But also, there is a focus on the Cold War and post-war period without even, you know, there's a show that he did titled B-Bomb, and it doesn't look at Japan. You know, so one wants to compliment one's predecessors and see them as collaborators. Mm-hmm. But I think there has been a feeling of having blinders on and of seeing the United States not as another provincial entity, as Okwi says, but as even the artist as a monolithic, as a monolithic being, and that when you see this the real problem is to see modernism as a Kunstwollen, which is transcendent and above national entities. So it doesn't have these provincial iterations in Germany, in France, in the United States, in Senegal, and everywhere. And so I think taking that line of Hegelian progressive history and turning it into a knot, in a way, and to use the term that Guha uses, has been really useful. And to see relationships, you know, rather than islands and rather than a line, has been important. Points of contact.
Thank you all so much for joining us. And thank you, Chika, Katie, Urish, and Gita. Thank you so much.